Well, good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on where you are in the world, and aloha from Washington, D.C. I think we're all sad to not be together in Hawaii this year, but alas, we're able to at least be with you virtually and appreciate your attendance at our seminar today. It is my sincere pleasure to introduce you to our panelists this evening for me. It's 5 o'clock my time. First, Oliver Camplin Warner, CEO of Telstra International. Mo Katiba, EVP and Chief Product and Platform Officer at AT&T Business. And last, but definitely not least, Nikki Palmer, Chief Product Development Officer at Verizon. Again, for all three of you, thank you so much. I know that I've gotten private messages with people very excited that you were able to attend today, so thank you. Well, today we get the opportunity to talk about the issue, or one of the issues that has really been kind of the focus and at the forefront for all of us personally and professionally this year, COVID-19 and the impact as it relates to businesses, families, you name it. So here we are in January, almost a year has gone by since COVID-19 just so really completely changed our lives worldwide. And over that time, telecommunications carriers have really faced significant disruption of their corporate operations, risk to personnel, while also trying to confront these new challenges and opportunities at work, at play, education, and healthcare that really forced them to move online in a matter of days or weeks, quite frankly. And the carriers and their employees have had to find new ways to address these issues, to do business, and to ultimately serve their customers' needs. And if you think about it, we're talking not only about your consumers like me, but your businesses who are now doing more online learning, telehealth, you name it. So I want to really start off by asking our panelists to kind of give us a little bit of information about what happened. Oliver, I'm going to start with you first. Then I'm going to go to Mo, and then I'm going to go to Nikki. And then on the second half, I'm going to flip the order so that way you guys can be prepared. So Oliver, let's start with you. What were some of the most immediate impacts on businesses from COVID-19?
Hey, good morning, everyone. A little bit early here in Hong Kong. Haven't had any coffee yet, but let's see how the energy levels go. I might answer the question, Charisse, in a couple of ways. I mean, first off, in terms of the impact on our international network, I mean, we saw a massive surge, right? A massive surge. If I look at IP transit, in that period between sort of February and June, I think it spiked some 79, 80%. The voice part of our network went up sort of 50, 60% in a very short period of time. International subsea capacity up 20%. So there's lots of numbers that we've kind of read about, we've seen, where we've seen this big sort of surge in demand. But the other way I'll answer the question is actually sort of looking at the silver lining. I think sometimes people took our industry telecommunications a little bit for granted. If I think about COVID and the impact it's had on the health of individuals, on jobs, on families, I mean, it's unimaginable really the impact it has had. But imagine if our networks, our industry hadn't actually stood up to those demands. Imagine if connectivity wasn't there for all of us to live, to work, to play day in, day out. I mean, that really is unimaginable. So I think the silver lining in this is there's actually been a real recognition of the role we play. Telstra International, we're the number one subsea operator here in Asia. Over 30% of internet traffic in Asia is carried on our networks. Imagine if all of that fell over overnight. I mean, that really would have been just an unimaginable sort of situation. So I think the silver lining is actually, it's really reinforced the role we play, and at Telstra we're really, really proud of that and the purpose that this industry really has. So a couple of impacts, both on the sort of the demand side, but also in terms of positive on the industry recognition.
Thank you. And I'm going to ask Mo and then Nikki kind of what their impacts are. And then I'm going to circle back around because I want to learn a little bit more about how you overcame these things. So Mo, what happened at AT&T? What did you see out there?
Well, you know, what I'll kick this off with is by reinforcing some of the points that Oliver made. And then, you know, I'll tell you a little bit about our internal operations and what we had to do there as well. So yeah, very similar. I'm sure every communications company on earth has a similar story on this. But for us, it was really about first seeing the shift of traffic from the urban core out into the suburbs and where people live, right? Everyone went remote. We started seeing every day we were watching maps of how traffic was originating on our network and watching how that was evolving over time. And it was truly incredible to see this just massive migration of people and the traffic that they're generating and things that they're consuming move to places that we wouldn't have expected it would have, like, even a month or two prior. And so, you know, what that means, again, very similar to Oliver, 20% increase in our broadband traffic. And we reach, call it about 400 petabytes of traffic every single day. An acceleration of many months of demand on our network. And then, frankly, it's never slowed down. So it's kind of, you thought this kind of step up function of about 20%, and then it's just maintained from there. And, you know, what I'm incredibly proud of is that, you know, there was essentially no impact to the network. So even though there was this massive influx of new traffic, we jokingly say voice got really sexy again. Like, a lot of people start talking on their phones, whether it's mobile or at home, right? Voice was the new hotness in 2020, as people were, you know, isolated but not alone. But the network, it didn't miss a beat, right? And that really is a testament to the way that we plan capacity, the way that we forward project where do we think capacity is going to be 18 plus months from now, and then build that capacity in our radio access network, the mobile network, our broadband network, the fiber to businesses and homes, as well as our backbone, right? The traffic, the network that carries the traffic across our network and across the world. And it really just reinforced for us that we were doing it in the right way. When you don't plan a network for a pandemic, but when one shows up and you're able to keep plugging along as if there was no change, it really reinforces the incredible work that our network teams do every single day. So that's a little bit by the numbers. And then, you know, when you think about—
Just a second, can we mute for those? Because I'm getting a little bit of feedback. Just a reminder to mute your phone if you're not speaking. Thank you, sorry, Mo.
Oh, no problem. And then from an operations perspective, while from an AT&T business perspective, we were off helping a lot of our business and enterprise customers and public and that small business figure out how to adapt to this COVID normal, inclusive of like millions of workers and students going home. At the same time, we had to send our own folks home. And, you know, one of the other things I was incredibly proud of early on was we were one of the first companies, I'll never forget this moment, on a Friday, second week of March, to just an email comes out at 2 p.m. that says, hey, 100,000 people are going to go start working from home starting Monday. And we're doing this to protect you, to protect our employees. So they were top of mind for us. And so everyone went home. And then very quickly, we had to figure out how we were going to enable those folks to be just as effective to go execute on their daily mission every single day from the house. And a cool thing for me was we immediately enabled all of our call centers with the solution that we actually sell in the market to our enterprise customers around virtual call centers. So, you know, we, for the last couple of years, we've had solutions in place that said, look, call centers don't necessarily need to be a place where people go. Call centers can be virtual. People can take their calls from anywhere. We can allow them to VPN securely into a network. We can then virtually route calls to the next free agent, whether they're in Oklahoma or California or Idaho or wherever. They take them. Management has visibility and the ability to talk to their reps. And so within literally about 10 days, we stood up all of our call center agents to use these same solutions that we've been offering in the marketplace. And the feedback that we got from them was fantastic. And I'm sure we'll get into this a little bit later as well, Charisse, but then that allows you to re-envision what the future of work looks like, right? The same questions that our customers have, we're able to address internally and say, hey, does this let us rethink what we might do in 2021 and beyond around virtual work, remote work, hybrid work, et cetera?
So those and are we are definitely going to get into that. So I'm glad you teed that up for me. But let me ask you another question. So you were able to handle it, which I think was one of the surprises, that it did go off without a hitch. Were there any other surprises that you thought, wow, you know, just didn't expect that, didn't see that coming, either from you or from your customers?
Well, what I'll tell you is, you know, the word surprise, I wouldn't use that one, right? So, okay. Again, all of us, you know, Nikki, Oliver, myself, our companies were built to address emergencies, whether it's hurricanes or natural disasters or man-made. And while none of us for 100 years have had to deal with a pandemic, essentially the approach, other than the, hey, now you're sending everyone home and how do you contend with that? It's the same approach to, you know, the network and how you support your customers, et cetera. So I think what was exciting and something that we took a lot of pride in was everything that I articulated versus a surprise that, you know, we weren't going to be able to do it. And then we pulled it off. Right. So it was just another reinforcement that, our teams are built for this. Right. This is an industry that's built to support humanity in all of their connectivity needs, whether it's, you know, calling your friends or commerce or safety or education or health, first responders, et cetera. That's what we do. I think we may be encroaching on some of the other questions, but I think the other unexpected, which quickly became the new normal, was while certain industries were going to be heavily impacted, there were essentially entirely new use cases that our business customers became very interested in.
We're going to hold that because we got to tease them. We want the audience to wait around for us. Don't give it up all now, Mo. So with that, I'm going to turn to Nikki. So Nikki, I love all of my children the same, but I must admit that I had more of a personal interest in Verizon since that is our telecommunications carrier. And I can say it was flawless from a customer perspective, but I'd love to hear from you what happened with Verizon and kind of your experience as this pandemic began.
Yeah, sure, Charisse, and thank you for being a customer. Thank you for the compliment, and thank you for asking us to be on this panel today. And so, whenever talking about COVID and the situation this past year, it's hard to start discussing it without first saying, what terrible destruction and it literally death in amazing and awful numbers across the world. So we're in a just unprecedented is, I don't like that word anymore. It's just so overused, but boy, is it, no one could have ever imagined. I will, however, echo a lot of the themes that Oliver and Mo brought up. So our networks were in fact built for this. I mean, Verizon reliability is the most important thing to us. And while we don't, build for a pandemic per se, whether it's Superstorm Sandy in the Northeast, or whether it's hurricanes down in the Southeast, or wildfires in California, we do build our networks for these situations. And we know, in fact, that that's when our customers rely on us the most. So it's critical that we have that kind of reliability built in and architected from the beginning all the way through to the response and the people that are actually helping out and doing what they need to do as they're deployed. So, crisis is not unusual for probably any one of us that has been in networking and in operations and engineering. So there's that. Now let's say when the pandemic first hit, similar situation, everyone starts working from home. But one thing that we did at Verizon, which I think was particularly helpful, is we started a daily call for all employees. It was noon to one Eastern time. And it was led by Hans Vestberg, our CEO, and our chief human resources officer, Christy Pambianchi. And the two of them every day for 6 months, it may even have been longer. It was at least for 6 months, because now we're still doing it every day, but they only make an appearance maybe, once or twice a week. But they were personally involved and communicating to all employees, because, and here's what Hans laid out for Verizon. He said, number one, caring for the health and safety of our employees is, job one. Number two is caring for and maintaining the reliability of our networks for all the customers, both individuals and businesses that are relying on it like they never did before. And then number three, helping society rise up and recover. So we'll talk about that a little bit more, but those were the clear, three priorities that were laid out. And then beyond that, we did certainly see the surge. Some of our numbers, they're kind of similar. We saw a 75% impact increase in gaming. So I know, you know, I had some of that going on in my house. I don't know about you.
I'll say my kids probably helped with those numbers.
You got it. Yeah, instead of school, maybe in some cases. I'll speak for my own self, my household. Video streaming went up 12%, and overall web traffic, we saw an increase of about 20%. Those are big numbers. And, you know, they moved around, they rise, you know, and fell, you know, over the summer in different ways, but definitely different traffic patterns, which really have to be recognized, because we build our networks based on, you know, what we see happening and usage that happens over, you know, in a given day, hour of the day of the week, et cetera. So this totally changed everything, but the network stood up and we're very proud of that. But in addition to just managing the network with everybody at home, we also had a new retail strategy, right? Where we went to completely touchless retail. And in fact, we trained a lot of our retail store reps to work in a call center. So instead of thinking about, you know, furloughs or how are we gonna make this work, we said, let's take these people, quickly retrain and, you know, support our customers in different ways, the ways that they really need it. So we did that. And I'm happy to say we also very early in the pandemic committed to actually increasing our capital expenditure for 2020. So instead of saying, oh, well, we're gonna pull back the reins, because I mean, remember, the economy was just tanking.
Yeah, everyone was scared.
Everyone was scared. And so we went in and we said, you know what? We're in this for the long run. We always have been. We build networks, we build them, you know, the best that we can. And there are some places where we could actually accelerate deployment, whether it's building fiber or adding antennas or digital permitting. I mean, there were ways when people aren't on the streets, when traffic sort of subsides, that maybe it becomes a little easier to build in the ways that we build. So we accelerated our capital expenditure for last year and continue putting technology out there because we knew that customers and society needed it now, and they'll need it for the future as we're entering a recovery phase. And that, of course,
can I ask a question about that? Because, you know, again, 5G has been, you know, we've been talking about that forever. And Verizon really has doubled, tripled, quadrupled down on that. And kind of what were the thoughts as you're really kind of, again, moving into this area that's so important to both you, your customers, and then you had that pandemic. Can you talk a little bit about that particular angle as well?
Yeah, well, I would just say, you know, for Verizon, I mean, we're leaning into the technology. I mean, and this goes back to our approach from 5G from the beginning, when people were talking about the technology arriving in the 2023-24 timeframe. And we said, it doesn't really need to be that far away. Like, let's convene some like-minded operators around the globe and some OEMs and infrastructure providers. And, you know, let's see what we can do. We came up with some early standards. I mean, some of this is history, but I bring it up to say that, you know, not even a global pandemic is going to keep us from our intent, which is to serve customers and, you know, with the latest and best technology that's reliable and allows them to do what they want to do, whether it's entertainment or learning or business. So, yeah, I mean, it really wasn't a thought, but it was a shift. It was, okay, we can't send technicians into people's homes. What do we do? How do we handle that? We have stores, they need to close right now. How do we shift? How do we do that? But when it came to sort of building the infrastructure, there were opportunities that said, okay, well, we're not gonna be able to do it here like we thought we would, but there's an opportunity over here in this particular city where we could go even faster. And that's what we did. So it exposed and it required a very agile you know, approach to deployment, which really, number one, is all about first taking care of your employees, because it's not just working from home and ensuring everybody's all set up, but it's also their well-being, their families, their mental health. So really focusing on our employees and, you know, are you okay? What's going on? And then how do we do what we need to do for our, you know, our contribution to society, being Verizon, is about communications, connectedness, and technology. So we just leaned into that. And I gotta tell you, it's a little brag moment, but all of that culminated in Forbes naming us the number one company on their corporate responder list for the top 100 companies, and Verizon took that honor. And, you know, we didn't respond in order to get an award, but I think, you know, it's
shows, always great. It shows, and like I said, your customers, all three of your customers really appreciate it. So I'm going to actually take it a little bit out of order. I'm going to go Oliver, Nikki, and then Mo. But all three of you have talked about the opportunity, the fact that it has really, you know, caused you to innovate, to really rethink things. So, you know, we've talked about the past. Let's move in our last kind of 9 minutes to the future. What has this made you do, and kind of what are you thinking for about 2021, 2022, 2023? So Oliver, I'll start with you, and particularly with that international aspect, you know, what are you seeing? What are you thinking? What is Telstra doing? At least confidential stuff.
Yeah, for sure. Hey, Charisse, first off, just kudos to Nikki and Mo. Amazing to hear those stories. Really sort of just reinforces the point around. I don't think were any surprises per se, Charisse. It was more just amplifying and kind of accelerating the focus on people and sort of capital expense, or making sure our international subsea network was sort of where it needs to be and our people were truly enabled and we were really looking after them, et cetera. So kudos to you guys for sure. And I think as an industry, why? Hey, in terms of looking forward, so a couple of things. First off, we were really pleased with some of the customer feedback we got in terms of how we supported them through those really, really tough times, right? We were getting calls saying, hey, the international demand is going through the roof. So if you think about, I don't know, the amount of Facebook posts or Instagram posts or whatever it is, all traveling on those subsea cables, they were just going through the roof as everyone tried to sort of keep connected. So we were getting phone calls from a variety of our customers saying, hey, we need this extra capacity and we need it now. Normally in our world, that kind of those kind of increases take 30, 60 days. It can take quite a while, right? You've got to sort of plan it out, make sure the capacity is there, et cetera, et cetera. But we were able to deliver those on a number of occasions in literally a matter of days. Customer feedback was very, very strong. So one of the things we're looking at, and Nikki touched on this a little bit, is that agility. So how do we become much more agile moving forward? I think in days gone by, it's always been, no, well, that's the way it is, and it takes a little bit longer, and we're going to work through it. Well, when you really put your mind to it, when you're in that kind of, in the heat, you can do things much more quickly. So that's point number one. I think point number two would definitely be just around digitization. I mean, we, like all other organizations, had a very sort of strong digital strategy and we were seeing adoption, it was going well. Was it going at the pace that it really could? No. And I think what the pandemic's really done is just put that on steroids. Consumers, our customers around the world, have become much more sort of comfortable with that sort of level of interaction digitally. And we've just seen that go through the roof. So that's another sort of critical focus area for sure. I think then the final point I was going to touch on looking forward is Telstra is a proud member of the Global Leaders Forum, GLF. And we are starting a conversation around how could we come together better as an industry, heaven forbid if there's another Black Swan event in the future. We're pretty proud in terms of how we did support one another. But as I said, heaven forbid, if something did come along in the future, how as an industry could we partner even sort of more closely? And hopefully we'll be able to sort of share some of that thinking in the not too distant future. So those are just a couple of things from a Telstra perspective, but love to hear from the others as well.
Oliver, one follow-up before I move back to Nikki on that. Do you think, because, you know, confidentiality, you know, protecting the corporate secrets has always been kind of the thing in a lot of these industries where this information is so valuable. At least for my clients, I saw that there was a lot more, hey, let's just sign the agreements to be able to share a lot more because we just got to get through this. There's a lot more we as an industry either rise or fail together. Did you see a little bit of that internationally?
I think internationally, I mean, we do, partnering is in our DNA a little bit. I mean, I love what Nikki said around the sort of the betterment of society and people. I mean, that's our purpose, right? So it's in some ways time to put aside some of that, those kind of that competition and that some friction which exists at times, and just sort of work out how can we partner to actually for the betterment of society overall. So as I said, Telstra International, we thrive on purpose and what we actually sort of do day in, day out for people around the world. And if that means sort of really taking partnering to the next level, then we are all up for that.
Yeah, no, it's been great to see. Nikki, what about you? What do you think's coming down the pike for Verizon? Or maybe I should say what's not coming down the pike, because I feel you guys, all three of you are doing so many amazing things.
No, it's a busy time and it's exciting time. I mean, there's some studies out there that say that COVID actually advanced technology about 6 years, and telemedicine, for example, has been advanced about a decade. And I'm sure we can all relate to some of the new ways that are being working. But by the way, it's not really technology that gets in the way there sometimes. It's some other things. And until you're put in a situation, do you find new ways to break down barriers that you thought were difficult? One example of that is we had a great app. It's called Bookfill. They take children's content, young, like under 10 content books, and they turn them into augmented reality content. It's really, really cool. So we had that ready to launch in our normal launch process, and the pandemic hit, and we thought, geez, is there a way to accelerate this? Because it might be useful to teachers and to students. And before you know, it was out in 3 days. So, that to me was a learning. So, why were we not doing that in the first place, right? So I think there were ways to accelerate that sort of, opened our eyes. And I think, just rethinking how we leverage technology across the board, there's so many examples. In the interest of time, what I would say is that the pandemic just moved. It's just a shift left. It's just a big time shift left that, the future of productivity that we were thinking about is now the current reality of work. The future of learning is now the current reality of our schools. The future of payments is now the current reality of banking and shopping. And the future of streaming is now the current reality of entertainment. So it's happening, all around us. Our enterprise customers in particular are leaning into their digital transformation in totally new ways because they've been, in some cases thrust into it. And you know what? Some of that's painful, but other times you realize that it's not quite as painful as we thought it might be in order to, to accelerate in these particular ways. We've had those learnings inside the company. And I think we are partnering, aggressively with our enterprise customers to leverage the power of technology. And for us, we're of course it's 5G, it's the mobile edge, it's private networks for enterprises. All of that is here now. We're not just talking about it as a future, it is here now, and there's a lot more that we're doing to leverage that, and customers want that. So it's exciting from that perspective.
No, absolutely. Those product cycles are going to be faster and faster. Yes. Sharing, communication will be faster. So Mo, you teased it. You're going to close for me now. So what is AT&T doing? What are those innovations we're going to see for you guys for the next couple of years?
Well, knowing the audience for this call is basically folks in our industry. I'll close this out with a couple of industry specific thoughts. Hybrid work is here to stay, right? Nikki gave some amazing stats. Another one is we saw acceleration of remote work 9 years. It was already going up. 9 years of new remote workers in 2 weeks. And so when you think about the people at home, the remote workers, I think we're gonna see adoption of SD-WAN technologies in the home to allow for prioritization of traffic, of enterprise business traffic above videos or gaming or something else, right? So if I'm presenting, I can make sure it looks really good. I think you're gonna see more connectivity options into the home. We've already announced that we're going to be building millions of new locations with fiber. Nikki's off building, fixed 5G across the country as well. So as an industry, I think you're going to see a lot more options there. And then cybersecurity in the home, right? The home has just become another branch. It's another place where CIOs and CSOs need to worry about their workers. We talked about call center reps that are accessing confidential customer information. So you got to make sure that's secure. And then stepping outside the home and thinking about the workers that still have to go in somewhere physical every single day, it's going to be about those advanced technologies that Nikki referenced. It's about millimeter wave 5G at the business location, whether it's a hospital, a factory, a retail store, a stadium, or a venue, to create incredible new experiences. And we could talk about that for an hour. But I'll say private 5G, millimeter wave, edge compute, IoT inside the business, to drive that next wave of digital transformation, take out costs, create better experiences, safer experiences for employees, as well as create new revenue streams and new wow moments for the end customer.
What a summary. I mean, I could not have asked for a better panelist and a better panel overall. Thank you, all three of you, Oliver, Mo, and Nikki, for a wonderful 30 minutes. For our audience, we are not gonna be taking Q&A or doing any questions right now, but PTC has been wonderful about providing contact information for all of our panelists. So I just want to, because you won't be able to hear everybody, I will clap for you guys and just say thank you again, not only for your participation in the panel today, but quite frankly, all that your companies have done for us as consumers to help us through this difficult time. I'm sure you don't hear it enough, but from all of us, thank you very much. And with that, thank you for attending our session, and we hope that you have a rest of a great PTC. Aloha from DC.